Hi, my name is Antron. Thanks for joining us again for the WeConnect Wednesday video series. Last week, we discussed how stereotypes can lead to prejudice and ultimately discrimination. Today, we are going to be discussing another result of stereotyping called marginalization. But first, let's join our friends at the Birmingham Civil Rights Institute.
This is called a shotgun house. It's so called because there was a long hallway that ran from the front door to the back door. So you could stand at the front door, fire a shotgun, and the bullet would go straight through to the back door. Shotgun houses are known for being very small and cramped, like this one. For example, Fred Shuttlesworth was the oldest of 9 children, and he had 2 parents. That's 11 people living in a space like this. But if you look around this shotgun house, you'll see fancy wallpaper, nice family portraits, these lovely lace curtains, nice furniture. This family is obviously relatively well off. So why would they choose to live in such a small, cramped space for their family? That's because of zoning laws. As you'll see on this map, people of color could only live in these black areas on the map. That accounted for about 11% of available city land. The problem arises when you realize that 43% of the city's population were people of color, forcing half of the city's population into 1/10 of the available land. They had no choice but to live in small shotgun houses like this one. Of course, these zoning laws didn't just apply to housing, but to commercial venues as well. In the city of Birmingham, all businesses supporting the black community had to exist between 3rd and 5th Avenues North and 16th to 18th Street. This area was collectively known as the 4th Avenue Business District, and all businesses that would serve the black community could be found here. Hotels, restaurants, department stores, everything. One of the most important business people in Birmingham, Alabama was a man by the name of Arthur George Gaston, more commonly known as A.G. Gaston. He was the first black millionaire in Alabama and one of the first black millionaires in the entire United States. He was a master businessman who, when he saw that there was a need for a business in the community, he would fill it. He owned a bottling company, a radio station, a life insurance company, a cemetery, and a funeral home. Because of those last three, people often said that he had to cover from the crib to the grave. Another important businessman in Birmingham, Alabama, was a barber by the name of Mr. James Armstrong. Mr. Armstrong was important for 2 reasons. First, he was Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King's barber. This was the chair that Martin Luther King would sit in every time he came to Birmingham to get his hair, when he would get his hair cut. Martin Luther King thought it was important to go to the barbershop for 2 reasons. First, he didn't want people to see him as this sort of deified figure that would lead them all to safety, but rather as a human who is leading the movement that they were all a part of. He also wanted to establish a personal connection to the people in the communities he was working in, so that he knew what he was fighting for and what they were fighting for. Mr. Armstrong was important for another reason as well. His 2 sons were the first students to integrate Birmingham City Schools at Graymont Elementary. In 1954, the court case Brown versus Board of Education finally proved that separate could not be equal. Now, that's not to say that no court case ever challenged the doctrine set forth in Plessy v. Ferguson in 1896. For example, in 1899, a group of black parents in Richmond County sued their Board of Education for introducing a tax that would only benefit white schools in the area. However, the Supreme Court held that this tax was constitutional and followed the doctrine separate but equal. In 1927, in the court case Gong Loom versus Rice, the Supreme Court held that 9-year-old Martha Loom, a Chinese American, could not attend the white school in her neighborhood because she could not be classified as a white person. She would have to choose between attending the school for people of color or staying home and not going to school at all. This court case not only upheld Plessy versus Ferguson, but also extended it to all people of color, not just black people. However, in the 1954 court case Brown versus Board of Education, Psychological research done by Drs. Kenneth and Mamie Clark was used to prove that separate but equal was not true in the classroom. This research consisted of Drs. Clark showing two dolls to a series of black school children. One doll was white and one doll was black. In almost every case, the black school children would choose to play with the white doll because through segregation, they were taught that white children were better than black children and that separate was not equal. The reason this court case is so important is because it really didn't just apply to this classroom. If separate but equal didn't hold in the schoolhouse, how could it hold in movie theaters, in restaurants, in churches, in the buses? And that's what starts our movement.
Marginalization is the unfair exclusion of one group to another group. When people are marginalized, it pushes them to a lower status and position, usually to the outside edges or margins of a society, often keeping them from having certain rights and privileges. When this happens, people are forced to live in a position of powerlessness and oppression. Throughout history and in the present day, groups of people have been marginalized based on traits such as race, gender, religion, and disability. Marginalization and oppression negatively affect everyone involved because they end up dehumanizing each other in order to justify their own feelings and actions. Desmond Tutu, a South African human rights advocate, once said, "Africans believe that a person is a person through another person, that my humanity is bound upon with yours. When I dehumanize you, I dehumanize myself." In other words, he is saying, when I put you down, I put myself down. One way you can help break down the walls of marginalization is by reaching out and connecting with people that may be overlooked or left out in your community. Have you ever felt marginalized? What ways do we marginalize each other? Is it ever justified? Share your thoughts and experiences in the comments. Thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next time.